This video is going to talk about how charges flow in batteries and wires. Over 150 years ago, Michael Faraday and others developed most of the theory of how electricity works, which was done by using the fact that all of matter comes in two distinct types we now call charge, where like charge types repel and opposite charge types attract. These types were categorized much earlier still, over 260 years ago, by Benjamin Franklin as plus and minus types. Just after Franklin designated the polarity types, the force of attraction between charges was worked out in 1767 by a brilliant French physicist by the name of Charles Augustin de Coulomb, which is now called Coulomb's force law after him. It is one of the fundamental forces of nature. It tells us that for any two chosen charged particles, the strength of the force between them is proportional to the product of the charges and inversely to the square of the distance they are apart. Through experiment, it was also discovered that charge comes in discrete, one-sized packets only, which as it turns out is exactly equal to the amount of charge that is on an electron, which are the outer orbital particles of atoms. So all collections of charges are multiple units of this single electron charge. This elemental charge is equal to 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. The protons within the nucleus of atoms also carry this exact same size charge, but with the opposite plus polarity, so that every plus charged proton in the nucleus of an atom is balanced by the same number of minus charged electrons that spin around it. It's this strong charge attraction of the tiny distances between these two particles within atoms that keep most of our universe neutrally charged. So to harness this fundamental force of attraction between unlike charges, all we need to do as engineers and hobbyists is produce large separated collections of minus and plus charges, and then by using the attractive Coulomb force between them, build useful circuits. For building such circuits, there happens to be something very helpful about copper and other metal atoms. Their outer valence shell electrons are very easy to dislodge. Just the heat of room temperature alone with copper, for example, can knock off a significantly large number of electrons from the parent atoms. All copper metals then have many of these dislodged electrons within them. Some describe this as the free electron sea or cloud. These free electrons, free as in free from their parent atoms, are all evenly distributed throughout the metal because of their mutual charge repulsions. So this property of having huge numbers of free electrons in the metal allows us to use the metal copper as an ideal material for the conduction of electrical energy. The traditional fundamental base unit for all electrical calculations is the coulomb, named after Charles Augustin de Coulomb. It represents 6.24 times 10 to the 18 discrete elemental electron charges, which is a huge number of charges. We normally only deal in millicoulombs or microcoulombs. With the coulomb defined, we can now describe the most important definition in electrons like so. The number of coulombs that pass through any cross-sectional area of a wire within a period of 1 second is a rate of charge flow given in coulombs per second. It has its own symbol I. Now one coulomb passing in 1 second is also a standardized unit called the amp, but I prefer to stick with coulombs per second. So for example, a current I of 2 amps is the same as saying 2 coulombs per second. Using coulombs per second instead of amps is just so much easier when thinking and learning about charge flow and energy. Current can be thought of as a flow of charge, a little bit like water currents are the flow of water molecules. Water molecules tend to flow from areas of high gravitational potential energy to low gravitational potential energy. Electric currents flow from high electric potential to low electric potential. And the greater the difference between the high and low potential, the more current that flows. I'll cover the definition of electric potential in another lesson. Now let's think about current directly from the charge's point of view. We are going to connect the terminals of a battery together with a length of copper wire. Now if we look at this from a negatively charged electron's point of view, we say that the higher potential is when the electron charges are at the negative terminal, and the lowest potential is for charges when they've reached the plus terminal. So then immediately the connection is made, due to the Coulomb forces between like charges, the negative terminal will release its closest and highest potential layer of electrons out of the battery into the wire. Likewise, at almost the same instant in time, the next layer of free electrons that are part of the copper wire will also be repelled by this first layer entering the wire, and then the subsequent layers will repel each of their immediate neighbours to also move, and so on and so on, so that this wave of nudged layers of neighbouring charges propagates instantly to the final layer of electrons at the other end of the wire, which enter into the attracting positive terminal. So these charges are all moving from a high potential to the lowest potential. The time taken between the first nudged charges from the minus terminal over to the final nudged charges on the plus terminal is not completely instantaneous, but almost. For copper, it's about 98% the speed of light. Note, this is how fast energy propagates. We are not referring to charge velocity here. Now, this layer of electrons from the external copper wire that enter via the positive terminal into the battery, these charges will all now be at zero potential energy. Now we can think of the internal chemistry of the battery as moving all these charges through the battery against the repulsive Coulomb forces of the opposing battery terminal. The work done to do this then is supplied by the battery's electrolytes, and hence gives all the charges that get moved through the battery back up to a higher potential energy, ready again to nudge their neighbours' charges through the external circuit. This will then cycle around continuously as a steady flow of charge, e.g. current, until either the wire is disconnected or the battery's chemicals become exhausted. So batteries are in fact energy providers. They do not produce any extra charges, they simply cycle or transport energy that is all used up by the circuit by the use of this instantaneous nudging of all the neighbouring charges. These are charges as electrons that already exist within the copper wire and the charges within the battery, continually cycling around and around the circuit as a current. Just think of the charges as simply a convenient medium for the transportation of the battery's energy. Energy is in fact transported within all electrical circuits close to light speed via this basic mechanism of neighbouring charges that already exist in materials anyway, repelling each other. For each complete cycle between the terminals of a battery, all the initial potential energy given out by the battery per charge is used up, expended within the wires and components of the circuit. If we wanted to, we could just as easily have talked about this cycle of current in terms of the movement of positive charges instead of negative ones. We can look at it from either point of view, because in all circuits, minus charges move one way and plus charges at the same time will move in the opposite direction. Here we just chose to describe it from the electron's point of view. It's just a lot easier to describe electrons moving than it is to describe the absence of them, e.g. holes, moving the other way. Hence why we chose this way of describing the move of charge through the battery. Okay, this can be hard to fathom when you first come across it, so this analogy can help. You can think of this complete current cycle, the internal charge movement within the battery, and the external charge movement through the external wire as one single cylindrical cylinder filled up with touching marbles charges, with a roller, the battery, at one end. This roller, as our battery, is moving the stack of touching marbles through the circular cylinder around and around. We will always make sure that our roller maintains a steady marble current, for example, say 5 marbles per second, by turning the roller's handle at a constant rate of revolutions. This roller will keep on moving the touching marbles around all the while it is touching the side of the marbles that get rolled by it. So this means when one marble is moved, they all will move at the exact same moment in time and at the same marble flow rate or marble current. So let's say then that a marble is moved by the roller out through the plus side, e.g. a positive charge leaves the positive terminal. Now since all marbles are touching, that means a marble will at almost the same moment in time enter the minus side of the roller, e.g. a different positive charge at the other end will enter the minus terminal. Now all the while the roller rolls at a steady rate, this current of revolving marbles will continue. So a push on the first marble will get that force transported in almost instant time to the end marble, which let's say is 1,000 miles away. This is very much like how energy is transported through wires using repelling charges instead of touching marbles. If all the marbles were perfectly rigid, this energy transport across the 1,000 miles, just like charges in a wire, would be close to the speed of light. What sometimes is surprising when you first find out is the fact that the speed of individual electron-sized charges themselves, average forward progress through the wires of all circuits, is very slow. Their progress is faster, although still slow through thinner wires than wider wires. All charges in wires at room temperature or above will be vibrating, and so will be moving faster in random directions. But their average forward progress is between about 2 to 20 centimetres per hour. So let's now pretend our external copper wire consists of a fat section of wire into a thin section, back into a fat section. Now we can appreciate, due to the cross-sectional area of these different sections of wire, that far more charges will be present in the wider section than the thinner section. Now, because all the charges in our copper wire are again similar to touching marbles, if at one end we have a current of 1 coulomb per second, that will mean that the other end must have the same number of coulombs moving each second as well, e.g. the current is the same throughout the circuit. This means that the thinner wire, which we know holds a lot less charges per cross-sectional area, will have its charges moving faster, because the coulomb per second rate is the same everywhere in the circuit, e.g. pushing the first layer of marbles at a given rate of marbles per second or current will mean last layer must also have that same rate of current. So for any fixed current value, individual charges will move faster through thin wires than through fat wires.